Good evening, everyone, and welcome to Isaka Square Table, the weekly webinar. Today is 28th of April, 2021, and I'm going to be your host for tonight. I would like to remind you quickly with the house rules. Practically, make sure that the name that appears in Teams is the exact first name and last name that you use for registration. This is, of course, for the CPEs. This presentation will be recorded and it will be shown afterwards. Also, the slides will be shared with you afterwards. I would like to remind you to mute your microphone and please stop sharing your camera. Because that sometimes affects the performance of the webinar. And also, if you have any questions, please use the text box as well as the maybe raise hand feature, and we will unmute you to proceed with your question. Today we have a very special speaker. Hiro is leading the Eclectic IQ activities in Europe and the Middle East. He advises government sector enterprises. He's the regional director for this company and also one of the experts in terms of like cyber threat intelligence analysis. Without further ado, I would leave it for him to start his presentation and also introduce himself. Hiro, welcome and rightly back to you.
Okay, Ramzi, thank you very much. I hope that you can hear me. And let me first bring up my screen and let me know if you can see it in presentation mode.
Yep, it's okay, presentation. Cool.
So, thank you again. I'm indeed the regional director of Eclectic IQ, and that region covers quite some square kilometers, since it's half of Europe, it's Middle East, it's Africa. Eclectic IQ is a global threat intelligence hunting and response technology provider, and we help governments, large enterprises, service providers manage that threat intelligence and create situational awareness and adopt an intelligence-led cybersecurity approach. We are founded in 2014 as a Dutch startup. We operate globally with offices in Europe, Northern America, and work with partners in 5 continents. And at the end of last year, we closed our so-called Series C with strong European investors. So really a Dutch or an organization with Dutch and European roots. And it's an honor presenting to you today. One remark at the bottom here, I'm not officially talking on behalf of Eclectic IQ tonight. I'm here as a member of the Isaka family and the views are my own. So what's on the agenda for today? I split it in 3 parts. First, something about the two-day threats and that requires an intelligence-driven response. Then I would like to talk about CTI within your information security program and within your organization, and then something about the evolution of cyber threat intelligence and share some best practices with you. So let me start with the first, some trends in threats, and you can make it as big as you want because there's so much information that just made a selection. And let me start here at the left side, the COVID-19 pandemic. That's a huge game changer, right? Suddenly we had to work from home. The edges of organization cyber defense became blurred and organizations became more vulnerable, and it is harder to respond to incidents and to contain it. That will have long-term impact, also since some adversaries use the situation to penetrate and to persist. There is a huge increase in threats related to COVID-19, including malware, weaponized websites, and phishing emails. And depending on the source, the estimates range from 300% to even 30,000%, like for instance CGI reported. The number of ransomware incidents tripled since last summer and still rising. And even concerning is the fact that attacks are becoming more complex and with more variations, with encrypted backup systems and blended extortion and ransomware attacks. And these attackers are aiming organizations with low downtime tolerance and consider a victim's annual revenue to determine their ransom. According to a recent report of SAP and Onapsis, there can be as little as 24 hours between a disclosure of a vulnerability and observable scanning by attackers looking for vulnerable systems. And just 72 hours before functional exploit is publicly available. Now, keep in mind, 92% of Forbes Global 2000, globally 400,000 organizations using SAP. 77% of the world's transaction revenue touches SAP systems, right? Just to mention some trends. Now, a year ago, at the beginning of the pandemic, people spoke about the new normal with social distancing and masks and work from home and more. I would call it the new reality for the physical world as well as the digital world. And in that new reality, we must have, or organizations must have, an intelligent response to these challenges. And using intelligence, well, there are different types of intelligence. We might be familiar with business intelligence, artificial intelligence, but I'm talking about threat intelligence. And that's a very old one. You can even see 2,500 years ago, the old warrior or general, you could say, of the Japanese army, Sun Tzu, he wrote or he made a point about if you know the enemy and know yourself, you need not fear the result of 100 battles. And that leads us already to, let's say, the briefest definition you can see at the bottom, that cyber threat intelligence is all about knowing what your adversaries do and using that information to improve decision making. So with reference to the trends and the new reality that I mentioned, organizations must respond intelligently to the threats, and I can break it down in three focus areas. At first, complexity, because of more complex attacks. In order to keep pace, one must understand the adversaries, their motives and TTPs, the indicators, and also what reports are available, what course of action, and more. In other words, the full picture and beyond IOCs. There's a lot of data or intelligence from different external sources available, such as open sources and communities, government, trusted partners, commercial vendors, and all with different strengths and different views. And in order to see the forest for the trees, you must be able to correlate, to analyze, and select the intel that really matters to the organization and the assets to be protected. The second is that there is a vast amount of data that I mentioned, or I mentioned the different sources, but there's also a vast amount that needs to be ingested and infused, filtered, and brought to the analyst as fast as possible, allowing him to analyze and produce intelligence for different use cases and stakeholders. Technology and automation must reduce the time and they spend on data, freeing up time for analysis and help them shorten the time to intelligence. The third point is about collaboration. Now, there's no single organization alone that can secure the cyberspace, and there is no reason doing so. So there are many opportunities for leveraging from the collective knowledge and skills, like intelligence vendors, trusted partners you might have, or communities such as ISACs, Information Sharing and Analysis Centers. And of course, also frameworks and standards are important, so we can speak the same language. The user is often the weakest link, so awareness is key, and awareness across whole organization, and maybe awareness even over sectors. So as part of collaboration. Now, let me illustrate it with an example in a threat intelligence platform. In this case, it's a Galactic IQ platform. And I'm using screenshots today to prevent any issue with bandwidth and that kind of things. And also to highlight sometimes a little bit for you where we are looking to. And we are here straight in the graph analysis. And we start with a phishing incident at the left side and an indicator that we received. Now, the indicator comes from Excellium and via a feed from the Luxembourg Computer Incident Response Center. We see some observables, not exciting yet, although the last one is already clearly indicated as malicious. You can see the three dots at the right side, the three red dots. And when we move to the neighborhood tab at the top, let me help you a little bit. So here, we see more entities related to it, including two reports, and we can pull that easily into our investigation. And here we go, left the incident, the indicator, then the domain variant, two indicators, and two reports related. Now, the domain is mentioned by different sources, and they are all correlated here already. So let's take a look at the Drydex malware report made by Flashpoint. That's one of the IntelliSys vendors, and that is considered as completely reliable. We can click for the full content, and that brings us straight into the ingested report with a summary, key takeaways, background, TTPs, that is the abbreviation of tactics, techniques, and procedures. At the bottom, you can scroll down and we see more. We see here some green text that are links to external sources. At the bottom, the analysis section. And after scrolling much more down, finishing with the related ransomware, the impact, possible mitigation, indicators of compromise. But it was already, these indicators, they are already loaded in the report. Now, there's also a second report from another Intel vendor about the Russian-speaking actor Glade, who offers malicious tools. If you go into the details of the report, so we go to the full content, we see the TTP and the analysis of the FTP replacement malware distribution tool that they provide. If you scroll down, we see impacted websites and servers of retailers, some industrial organizations. And then we go back to the neighborhood again. We see there is a wealth of entities available within the knowledge base, and the platform selected already the 30 most important ones. So we load it all into the graph, and now it becomes already quite complex. But let me guide you through it. So the report leads to the threat actor Glade and a corroborative report. Some hashes here at the right side. Two concrete domains and related reports and indicators. At the left, a domain used for typo squatting, Amazon NAS, not news, but NAS, with high confidence that it is malicious. Connected to this domain, a malware variant called Fahrenheit and attack patterns met on the MITRE attack framework. So we learned a lot in a few minutes, right? I think this was maybe 2 minutes. Now, how to make it actionable now? For instance, by sending the list of the return paths, that's what you see here, clicking on this indicator, return paths, and other indicators to the infrastructure team that you have, and let them take the right protective measurements. Or by saving the investigation for further analysis, now or later, when new intelligence comes in, and the analyst can be alerted based on an automated discovery rule. And the analyst can write a report, of course, to make different stakeholders within the organization aware of the threat and potential remediation and more. So let's look now to how CTA fits within your, let's say, organization and information security program. And the best way of doing that is just starting with what's called the intelligence cycle. The intelligence cycle is a fundamental cycle of intelligence processing in a civilian or military intelligence agency or a cyber threat intelligence team within an enterprise. So it has 5 steps, and I will go through them one by one. So the first step in the cycle is planning and direction. And that's all about the business context and information security governance, program, risk management, and within the latter, threat identification and scenarios. And that all supported by frameworks and that provide direction for the intelligence practice resources, the expected output and timing, or in other words, the intelligence requirements. Then it subsequently also determines what data needs to be collected and where it can be acquired. That starts with a so-called data collection plan with priority intelligence requirements and details down via the indicators and the specific information request to detection point. And you can find a nice public available example that's made by SANS by the link at the bottom. So if you want to have some inspiration, I recommend you to download that one and take a look. Now, the second step here is the next step, that is to determine where to get it from. I call that data acquisition plan. And of course, what you already have in your organization, such as telemetry and reports, and in particular, telemetry can be quite used. Some organizations build so-called data lake or data lakes for it. And what you don't want to do is duplicating that into your threat intelligence solution. So some aggregation, some filtering, some business rules, maybe some smart algorithm are needed then. Regarding external resources, there are hundreds, if not thousands, of open source sources. But there is also a lot of duplication there and questionable quality, even to the risk of putting you on the wrong track. So I do recommend you asking some advice that could be by peers and partners or ISACs, might help you with selecting as well as with using intelligence. If you look to the commercial vendors, there are about 50 commercial vendors worldwide, all with different strengths, with different quality, with different business models, price levels. So also here, ask advice, test, and don't trust the marketing at flat face. If you want, you can give me a call as well, and I will refer you to the right resources. By the way, if you have a threat intelligence platform that enables you to track the intel through your tip and does a proper deduplication process, then it also helps you with the evaluation of the sources over time, because in the end, you can see what intelligence was most valuable to you and where did it came from. Then the third step is the processing and exportation of the collected data. It's all about processing the incoming data streams into the full knowledge base. And intelligence people always like collecting data, so that can be quite big. And I do know situations that organizations are creating a haystack, you could say, and consequently the analysts are searching for a needle. So having one big collection of data without further organization in it. So for the efficiency of your intelligence team, and also for the quality of their analysis, I really do recommend you paying enough attention to organizing the data, for instance, along threat scenarios that I mentioned already in step one, or the priority intelligence requirements, as they call it in the intelligence field and the peers, or along teams, for instance, or very specific topics. And here you see an example at the left side of a screenshot of Eclectic IQ platform, and we use the concept of what is called workspaces for organizing all the data and for analyst collaboration. Now, in this step of the cycle, we have the best opportunities for automation and for enrichment, for fusion and for discovery. Another point for attention is how data is fused. Intelligence vendors provide data as threat model, and some solutions in the market ingest the data as a threat model. Now, that sounds logic, but imagine the following. APT-28 was originally called Fancybeer by Malmyard, but they were acquired by FireEye, and they call it now SETNIT or SAR-Team. Kaspersky, however, calls the same APT Palmstorm or Sophisy Group, and Microsoft calls the same APT-28 Strontium. So if you have multiple sources using different names for the same APT, and you have to ingest them as one individual threat model, you must do the correlation manually. That's needless to say, the impact that it has on time and on the quality. So it's important also to look to these kind of details if you look to technology that supports your intelligence process. And that starts already here in this first phase by, okay, what data to ingest and how does the ingestion, how does the fusion work. The fourth step is analysis. And you've seen already some when I did the phishing incident. It could be what's called standing or continuous monitoring, so standing intelligence or standing priority intelligence request, or continuous monitoring, you could say, of a threat, or specific and much more ad hoc. And this is where the human and automated threat intelligence come together. And technology helps, of course, connecting the dots, and the analyst can produce relevant and timely analysis. He can add his own observations and save it for later, or share it with our team members. That's usually what you see, or disseminate it, of course. And that brings us already to the fifth step. But before doing that, what you see at the left side is an example, for instance, that is a graph analysis with different entity types. And the icons that you see here, like the red, let me use my mouse, the red mask, or the purple towers, the fingerprints here, that are the STIX icons. And STIX is the open data model for cyber threat intelligence. And the distribution of intel, we are doing that by a model that's called TACSI. So you might have heard before, if not then the first time, about STIX TACSI. That are the worldwide open standards in cyber threat intelligence. So in this example, you directly see what it is, right? And you see some panes here. This one is related to the report of an NCSE here. At the right side, some controls that indicates also in this situation here that it is an interactive graph. So you can do analysis, not only by raws and tables and more as an analyst, but really interacting with this kind of visualizations. There are technologies also that just present dots and lines. And yeah, it all depends on the use case that you have. I will come back on the importance of use case later, but it depends on the use case that you have and the analyst task that you have. And I do recommend also by checking carefully to what level you need this kind of, let's say, graph support for your intelligence requirements. Brings me to the fifth step. And the fifth step is about dissemination. That could be by reports for decision making. So something that a human can read, reports for, let's say, risk mitigation by the steering committee or your CISO, or to create awareness, or as concrete input for all the cybersecurity defense processes. And dissemination also has feeds and integrations to operational security systems for monitoring, for network and endpoints, orchestration. Integration can be in two directions. And most common one is the integration within SIEM solution. One of the benefits there is the reduction that's possible of the high number of false positives. One of the biggest let's say challenges we always hear when we are talking with people in security operations centers, welcome in a SIEM, that is how they have to deal with the many false positives. Well, if you have intelligence and you have much more context, that really helps you. If you combine these two, you could say security controls, to reduce that number and make also your SOC more effective. So when we speak about intelligence-driven cyber defense, or intelligence at the core of your defense, yeah, we just have seen that the circle starts with planning and direction. And that comes from your information security strategy, governance and program, and the organization context, of course. And it ends with integration with the security controls and with reports for various purposes. And on strategic and tactical and operational level that you can make these reports. So I've mentioned a couple of times something like beyond IOC. And IOC stands for indicator of compromise. And the graph left has STIX icons, like I mentioned before. So campaigns, tools, indicators, course of action, technologies or tactics, threat actors. And the indicator at the left side, this fingerprint, let me point it with my mouse, this one, is the item for the IOC. But yeah, as you can see at the right side, like on a real physical crime scene, fingerprints are important pieces of evidence, of course, but don't tell you the full story. And to find and catch the attacker and having enough evidence bringing him to court, you need much more. Now, even more in the digital world, without physical limitations and with possibilities for an adversary to repeat and scale up to enormous volumes. So therefore, it's important to understand how they did it, what tools and infrastructure they used, for what reason and more. And the term often used is TTPs, that's the abbreviation of tactics, techniques, and procedures. Now, there's an interesting blog and report about Beyond the IOC available via the link at the bottom. It's a free report, so if you are interested, know more about it, you can go there or just let me know and I can help you with it. So now many organizations, when they initially start with cyber threat intelligence, they focus on what we call aggregating IOCs. So in fact, they have different sources, aggregate the IOCs, and then send it to their SIEM solution. And that's, of course, a good use case, for sure, it is, but it's also limited, as I have explained already before. Now, it provides, in fact, a limited view on what happened. It's always after the fact, you could say. Think about the crime scene. And it doesn't help you much to anticipate and prevent further harm. So why do they focus then on it? Because it's quite easy. Here you see the pyramid of pain. Maybe you are familiar with it. And according to David Bianco's, I think it was a blog quite some years ago, 2013, 14, something like that. He said, well, typically IOCs, such as hashes, IPs, domain names, they are trivial or easy and simple. But the TTPs are tough and require tradecraft, technology, and collaboration. And what we have seen, and let me link it back now to some of the things that I mentioned in the beginning about trends, what we have seen is that it's quite hard for adversaries to really change the complete TTP. So what they do is working with a lot of variables. That means if you only focus on the variables, you are quite limited. But if you understand how they do it, so again, what tactics, what techniques, what procedures they are doing, then you are much better prepared or equipped to understand that if something happening, it's part of that bigger TTP, and you can respond to that. So let me illustrate it with a case. A couple of years ago, we were doing a POC, so a proof of concept, with a customer in Southeast Asia. I cannot expose what customer and what country exactly, only it was in that region. So this customer was also very focused on IOC aggregation. And we had a couple of discussions with them about the value and the limitations of it. And then suddenly, the largest healthcare organization in Singapore, Singhealth, did an announcement about what they described as a very serious and unprecedented massive cyber attack, in which healthcare records were stolen from about 1.5 million patients, including the prime minister and some other VIPs. So I want to make clear again, we were not working with Singhealth, and I'm not saying that we were in Singapore. I cannot say exactly where it was in that region. So our customer was very concerned and asked, like, is this Singapore only? Is it against healthcare only? Or the VIPs, government VIPs, or also public sector, private sector VIPs, or enterprise VIPs? And why? More of that kind of questions. So we said, well, if you want to understand based on IOCs, you must have some patience. And it turned out later, it took about 2 weeks before the Intel community was able to publish IOCs. So we said, let's take a deeper look to the announcement. What can we learn from it? And use other forms of intelligence that helps us getting a better understanding and possibilities for our defense. So we look to the full announcement. And what I've done now here, I split it in a couple of parts, and we will go through it. And before I say more, I give you some time to read it first. So what do I see here? First, that they were targeting Singapore and SingHealth as a healthcare organization, that they illegally accessed and copied the data, so we can say data of that, that it was not with a financial interest, so financial data was not stolen, first of that. We will see more about it, because there in Singapore, the NRIC number is not like you have in some other countries that you can, that it is important for financial transactions. It's not. You cannot do any financial transaction with it. Ransomware was not used at that time. We are talking about, it's almost 3 years ago. That time there were a lot of healthcare organizations dealing with ransomware attacks. Of course, we have seen it also the last year. But this was 2 years before already. It was not here, the case. So the second part, and I give you some time to read it. So what do we see here? Targeted, well-planned attack. So it's likely an APT. Not casual hackers or criminal gangs who are usually motivated for money. They are not financially motivated. What we do know is that there was database infiltration, right? So on July 4th, 2018, the IHS database admission detected unusual activity. What we also have is some metadata. We have a time frame here. So what we see here is that SingHealth took some measurements that included temporary imposing internet surfing separation, which indicates that the way they came in was by phishing and watering holes. They came in via one system, and work station, and then to the server. So you could say privilege escalation, lateral movement, a couple of other things. This is the last one. I'll give you some time to read. So, and here you can see, okay, the target, they were targeting the government official, Prime Minister Lee. Once they entered the system, they also planned ahead. In the weeks prior, being discovered in July 4, they had stolen login credentials, covered their tracks, probed for more entry points. So really with a long-term access and intention to persist, they worked in teams. And again, initial attack was detected and halted. The threat did not stop, so really persist. Using malware infected, so using malware and malware infected from the workstation. So if we summarize that and use the DIMOD model, which is another often used model in cyber threat intelligence, then we can summarize what you see here. So the adversary worked in teams with the intention to persist. What we see here, for not for financially or not financially motivated, with a set of capabilities here at the right side, right, using malware, left, and targeting same health organizations for PII and health records of the government, prime minister, and other government VIPs. So the next step, what we did, that we used that knowledge based on the model that we just saw and some open source data sources, and we used Eclectic IQ platform for further analysis. And the example is 3 years ago, also the user interface that you see here, but for the purpose for today, that's not important. Now, the first step is defining a couple of data sets that you see here. One about threat actors and intrusion sets, as you can see at the right side. The other data set was one with campaigns. Then a third one for TTPs, all by search queries, as you can see here, right? Coming or against the full knowledge base. And these three data sets, and they can be browsed as one data collection for analysis, but also presented on one graph like this. And you directly see that the system made already correlations. The intelligence request or objective in this case is to get an indication of the potential threat actor. Now here in the middle, and at the right side here, you see some single entities. They are not correlated. We call them singletons, and they are not helpful at this stage for our investigation. So what we do, we can easily filter them out with the control at the right side. Remains clusters, but some of them have no attack vector, no red mask. And since we want to understand potential adversaries, without a mask, these clusters don't have much value. So we filter them out as well. Remember, we had some metadata like time, right? And at the bottom, there's a control to adjust the time window. And if you do so, it narrows it down to about 10 clusters. And again, we see that we have some clusters without an attack vector. And we select and group them in what I call park them. So we select them and we group them and we put them a little bit aside. You can see it here. They are now collected here, so they are not completely gone. But for the objective that we have for this analysis, they seems to be less important. And as a result now, we have 5 clusters with attack vectors. And then it's time to go deeper, to look deeper into it. So by going deeper into it and looking to the details, the first one that we look to is this one about intrusion set rancor. It's targeting Southeast Asian political organization with particular focus on those in Cambodia and Singapore. So makes sense. Second one, threat actor Gold Lowell, and they deploy some ransomware and demand payment. But as we have seen, that was not the case in Singapore. So quite unlikely that this one matters. The third one is about Dark Overlord. And in the full report text, we see healthcare organizations, but also demand for ransom. So quite unlikely that's relevant. And you can go to all 5. But after checking all, just 3 remained. And most likely, or remained as most likely, and rather than waiting 2 weeks till you have some ICs, you can use it already. You can use it to get to know more about these 3 attack vectors. It's like a kind of Diabolo. Eh? In the beginning, you have a lot, and you go down to the 3, most likely, and from there you want to know all. And you can also take measurements and instruct security operations about what might be going on or what kind of activity requires extra attention and more. So this process took a couple of hours, and most of the time was to prepare and define the right data sets that we did in the beginning. It's a simple example that there is much more than only IOCs, only indicators of compromise. Now, before we move on to part 3, a few words about another important framework, which, to be honest, can be a complete subject itself. It's the MITRE ATT&CK framework. So I mentioned the TTPs in the top of the pyramid of pain, and they are quite bad, right? But the MITRE ATT&CK framework helps you with it. It's a knowledge base of adversary behaviors It's based on real-world observations. It's free, open, globally accessible, driven by community contributions, and the framework is updated twice per year. It's a tremendous tool for analysis. It's not actual threat intelligence, it's a framework with adversaries' tactics, techniques, sub-techniques, procedures. Most tips, so most threat intelligence platforms, map intelligence to the MITRE ATT&CK framework. The framework has an enterprise, so let's say IT, and an OT, operational technology, matrix. And in the enterprise, for instance, 14 tactics that you see at the top, and then under it or below it, the techniques, the sub-techniques, and the procedures. You can create your own layers over the full matrix. So a lot of very helpful possibilities with it. And as mentioned, it's really a topic on its own. I only wanted to mention it now. It's very valuable in your intelligence cyber defense. So we are now at the third topic that I would like to talk about, and it's the evolution of cyber threat intelligence, and then finishing with some best practices and other considerations. So the CTI industry is quite young. All TIP vendors are startups, and for about 5 years, maybe six, active in the market. The early adopters of the technology were national agencies like NCCs, National Cybersecurity Centers, and CERTs, defense and civil intelligence teams or agencies. In terms of regional and national leadership, we can say that Europe is ahead of the pack, and that's with thanks to ENISA and to the NIS directive. As a result, the European Council were the first with establishing these NCSCs and CERTs, and then some other agencies followed. The main demand of their main demand was or is a central repository of knowledge, and being able to produce their own intelligence and then share it with their constituents. So with a high emphasis on the collaboration and exchange of it. So that was the starting point. But over time, other organizations, for instance, the financial sector was one of the first, or other type of organizations within what's called critical national infrastructure, also start applying cyber threat intelligence. But for them, it's different because their mission, you could say, is not collecting intelligence, produce new, and share with constituents. For there, it's about defending their own organization, defending their own assets. So what you see with these organizations, that the emphasis is much more on security operations and combining threat intelligence with the different, you could say, security processes or security controls. So, for instance, related to endpoint detection and response, or to vulnerability management, just to mention a little example. So there, it's more what we now call threat intelligence management. So how to manage all these incoming intelligence data correlated to what's relevant for your organization, for the assets, for the technologies that you have, for the type of organization that you are. And so using it for that, but then really embedding it, you could say, into the operational securities. So an interesting source of knowing more about this is this podcast that has, I think now about, it's January 5th, so almost or more than 4 months ago. Done by a podcast called Down the Security Rabbit Hole. I think they produce every week at least an interesting podcast related to security developments. And Joep Gommers, the CEO of Atlantic IQ, spoke on January 5th with Rafa Los about threat intelligence management enabled next-gen SOC platforms. So really about, okay, this is the evaluation of threat intelligence over the last 5 years. Where are we now? And where is the whole industry moving to? And that's also what I mentioned in the previous slide, from TIP more to TIM, more to next generation SOC platforms and more. So with the link, you can go to it, and I really recommend you if you want to get a bigger picture about what I mentioned, the history, how it's all developed, where we are and where we're heading to. That brings me to the last couple of slides, and that's sharing some best practices with you if you consider to start a CTI initiative or building even a CTI practice within your organization. It's maybe with other functions as well, it's always about make room on the organization chart. Lock down some IT capacity. So it's not just a matter of acquiring some intelligence sources or having someone on board who did, for instance, a SANS training, because then you don't get the value out of it. It's really a matter of organize it. So make room for it on the chart. Make sure that you have IT capacity, because collection of data, you can imagine that is quite a lot of data. It's not just something that you easily can do. Build also a well-balanced core team. So if you think about intelligence, you might have people with an intelligence background coming from intelligence agencies. You might have some people who might have a background more in the operational security, blending there, especially when it is for, like I mentioned, threat intelligence management and defending your assets, is valuable. But you can also think about some intelligence analysts are more into producing intelligence on an operational level or a strategic level. Some are more into very specific topics, like, for instance, everything related to the networks or maybe to certain apps or certain malware. So there are differences. And of course, it depends on how big your team can be. But make sure that you have a well-balanced core team. Manage the right collection of CTI feeds. I've made already a couple of comments. There are different feeds, different qualities, different business models. Is really something that you have to manage. If not, then you have to risk that your CTI initiative fails quite early for the simple fact that you are not able to produce valuable intelligence. Bootstrap it with technology platforms. And then you see three bullets here. Deliver stakeholder focused CTI solutions, achieve stakeholder buy-in, provide specific support for stakeholder or to stakeholder groups. It's all about stakeholders. So if you talk about stakeholders, who are they? You can think about the security operations center, right? And they usually receive too many warning signals associated with threats, are therefore unable to discern or respond to the most important threats. So their interest is really receiving good threat intelligence that helps them focusing, helps them reducing the noise, as I mentioned before. You can also think about vulnerability management team. It's quite often hard for them to distinguish between the low impact and the high impact IT systems vulnerabilities, or encounter delays in responding to known exploitation factors that I mentioned with the SAP example in the beginning. Incident response teams, usually they have difficulties with assembling an accurate picture of the precise state of the organization at a point in time prior to or during an attack. Business stakeholders remain largely unaware of the threat level before something happens, or they have or only a kind of vague sense of what happened. IT architects, they make decisions about IT infrastructure that might be or maybe costly to retrofit with better security. You can think about executives and decision makers. They might have a limited understanding of the exposure of the organization prior to an incident. So that's probably intelligence not on operation, but really strategic level. If the organization is an organization that is, for instance, at the government and produce intelligence. So that's all about what kind of constituents, or if you are an MSSP, a managed security service provider, what kind of customers do you have and what kind of industries? So very important that when you start your initiative that you take these considerations.
Here, would you allow me to interrupt you for a second? There is a question coming in. Would this approach also work on operation technology, cybersecurity environment? So I just wanted to interrupt if you don't mind.
Yes, it does. The approach does. The intel is, of course, different. So the practice of cyber threat intelligence can be applied on, let's call it IT and OT. But the type of intelligence is different, and the integrations that you have might be different. In particular with OT, there are huge amounts of telemetry available. And this is a good example that I mentioned before. You don't want to copy that. You want to do something. You want to connect probably with your threat intelligence to the data lake where you have all that kind of intel. So it's more an aspect of integration and an aspect of what intelligence. So let's give another example. One of the leading intelligence organizations in the world is Dragos. They are very specialized in intelligence related to OT. So it's more about that. And it's not about how you produce intel, how you do your analysis as an intel analyst. It's more about integration and what data that you use. So hopefully that that answered the question. And if not, we can maybe come back later on that, or you can reach out to me directly. Yeah.
Thank you so much.
It's one of the last slides, and I'm also looking to the clock. So other considerations, always about the business context. So what is the strategy as an organization? What is the context that you operate as an organization? What is your risk appetite? What threat scenarios that you have? I mean, that's the starting point that I explained with the intelligence cycle. Then use cases. The use case can simply be something like, okay, IOCs, I want to aggregate and send them to the SIEM. I don't have intelligence analysts. I don't have someone who can look to it. I just want to have something that is as automated as possible. Well, that's a use case. And if that's your reality, then nothing wrong with it. But if you want to be able to discover more manually or automated, that means you have to look to something, right? And if you want to do, for instance, threat actor monitoring, so really looking to, for instance, a campaign of a threat actor and try to understand what they are doing and monitor them closely, of course, that's another use case and requires other capabilities and other skills of the team that you have. SOC augmentation, that's really combining, as I mentioned before, the SOC or the SIEM with the threat intel. Collaboration, what you see with government agencies or in a more commercial way with MSSPs. So use cases are very important because they determine a lot what kind of technology choices, what kind of skills you need in your team, what kind of implementation processes that are required. Then data sources. I've made already a couple of comments, but also think about the old, you could say, three V's from the world of big data with volume, variety, and velocity, because that sets requirements for the completeness and the robustness of the ingestion process. If you are an agency, for instance, or you are an enterprise with very short, let's say, or a requirement for very short timelines between there is something and we want to respond on, we want to report on it, then if you have an ingestion process of intelligence and that are always quite, let's say, big, not structured intel sometimes, then that must be quite robust. That if it fails, that you don't automatically miss intelligence, or that you, as another example, that you duplicate intelligence with all the consequences of that. So depending on the, you could say, business context, robustness of the ingestion process is another thing to look for. Teamwork, so that depends on what analyst do you have. I spoke about balanced team, but also think about maturity levels. If they are specialized in some topics, is it possible that some analyst is working on some parts of the analysis, for instance, related to network, and then share his insight to someone else, but who can use it from there, right? So in rather than having analysts doing a lot of same work, right, how you really can benefit from that small team. Because one of the biggest challenges We all know that there are not enough people in the field of cybersecurity, but if you come in the field of cyber threat intelligence, it's even more difficult. So it's always important to focus on how can we make sure that the intelligence analysts are not wasting too much time on, let's say, engineering tasks, but really focus on making analysis. And that depends on, for instance, teamwork and tools and how efficient they can work at more. CTI vendor. So I didn't mention that too much in the beginning, but let me explain it. If you look to the cyber threat intelligence market, you have organizations that produce content like reports and feeds. They also do other things because they don't get it from nothing. It's by a lot of other security tasks they do that they are able to produce these reports and feeds. Then you have this more recently so-called digital risk protection organizations. They are more like a service provider doing some of the intelligence tasks sometimes for customers. They might have a kind of portal. Might be possible that you can integrate it to one of your controls. And then you have the market or the vendors for TIPS, threat intelligence platforms. And TIPS basically have the function of ingesting all kinds of sources, allow you to do deeper analysis, produce intel, and integrate it with all kinds of technologies that you have. So that are really different players in the market. So if you look to your organization and you say, okay, I want to do, or I want to use cyber threat intelligence, then the question is, okay, what? Is it just content, that a report that you want to read, or is it a feed that you want to ingest in your scene? Or would you like to have someone who is looking for you on the dark places of the dark web and find if there is something like dumped credentials or something like that? Or is it being able to ingest intelligence from all kinds of sources and connect it to your infrastructure and more? And there are TIP vendors, for instance, with a certain emphasis. So there are TIP vendors who have, for instance, TIP and orchestration. Their vision is that like working with playbooks, you can define, let's say, intel and how you respond and how you use it into your daily practice. And the focus is really on getting fast processing of it. While you have also, for instance, others who are very focused on combining the SIEM and the TIP. Well, for instance, Eclectic IQ, where I work, is also based on the background, but we focus more on what we call an analyst-centric platform for multiple use cases, and where we combine intel with hunting and with responding. So there are also in the industry of threat intelligence really different flavors, and you have to look to what is the right flavor for you. How can they help you with your journey on cyber threat intelligence? And that brings me to last slide. So I received already one question. Maybe there are more questions.
Yes, Hero, thank you. And you also received a lot of thanks and gratitude from the attendees on the chat. I would like to invite everyone to please raise your hand, and if you'd like, unmute and ask Hero the questions, please. Also, meanwhile, for people who don't have a question, if you'd like to have another, if you'd like us to have another, let's say, cyber threat intelligence discussion for the second half 2021, think about some of the topics listed on the slide and maybe others, and write us on the chat what would you like to hear about. Meanwhile, do we have any questions, please? Okay, I think we don't have more questions, Hero, but what we do have is a lot of thank you coming in. So I would like to thank you so much on behalf of Isaac and Netherlands chapter, and also Nouria as the supporting organization for Square Tables. And I would like to thank our participants, remind them that the next one is 12th of May, 2021, Managing IT Healthcare During a Pandemic. And the speaker is Ivan Sanchez Lopez. So hopefully we see you soon on that one. And again, thank you so much, Hero, for this great presentation. Have a great evening, everyone.